Okay, let's have a look at Paul Hall art. Take it down to 100. Let's take it to 110. Okay. We're looking at the art literature section. It's New Year's, so we got a couple of drunks screaming outside there at 3 a.m. You know, it's like as Descartes used to say, I think, therefore, a.m. Must have been, you know, from the South. Southern accent. I think, therefore, a.m. Well, okay, let's see. High water, 96. Wow. There should be actually, if there's an embedded audio in here. And I guess it's not going to play it anymore. This is an old Java, you know, and by now, all this is obsolete. There's an interesting little thing. I had this sky was supposed to look. You see, there's the pink in the sky. It was supposed to look a little bit more like this bluish gray up here. And the problem is, that's interesting. There's also something here. Looks like a letter appearing here. But anyway, when I painted this, I used titanium white, and my elderly mother had champagne tastes. And she cooked this kind of a scampi meal in the kitchen, and in the kitchen of my trailer there, a small kitchenette area. And I think the iodine from the shrimp interacted with the titanium to make this pinkish color here. So to my horror, the color has changed. Maybe it's for the better. Now, what happened is, in order to get into this, I really need to go over, I don't think it's here. Encounter at the Half Moon Cafe. Which I think that is in my whoops, I forgot. Never do this. With Google, because you're in a split second, you're going to come up with, like, here, 3 million results of Half Moon Cafe all over the place. Of course, Half Moon Bay and everything. So also get specific. Half Moon Cafe. There we are. Let's see what we've got here. Yeah, it's in the Covered Bridges homepage in Paul Hall Art. So I wonder where it is, maybe up here. No. It's one of these articles that's hard to find. Nope, can't find it. All right, so basically what happened is I severely dislocated my arm. It took 12 years to heal. It really isn't totally healed now. I couldn't afford to go to doctors, so for a while I was working as a cart gatherer in Claremont, New Hampshire, and this is the Sugar River in Claremont, New Hampshire. And it was called the Sugar River because the colonies had, during the colonial era, it was a very big sort of cash crop plantation type area along the upper parts of this river around Lake, oh my goodness, I can't remember the name of the lake. Maybe it'll come back later. No, can't remember about that. Oh, Lake Sunapee. Yes, I can remember. 20-second delay there. Lake Sunapee, they had a huge riverboat on that, a big boat on that lake. For the early part of the 20th century, it was quite something. Anyway, Lake Sunapee had two covered bridges that were actually railroad bridges going across, and a sort of railroad bed. Running from Newport to Claremont. Now what happens is this area was a stupendous area for mill power back in the days of the colonies. And so the cash crop of the Sugar River was maple sugar, maple trees, and it still is a big deal to this day, a lot of maples, the sugar going on, sugar shacks where they boil down the tree sap. And this is one of the old buildings. This one was, I can't remember now the type of factory it was. This one that was actually early 20th century, or well actually not 19th century. These were powered by water wheels. There were other, the first one was opened up in something like 17 or 1690 or something. They had a huge celebration. A lot of water power used extensively throughout here. And these mill areas, the women from the farms, daughters and so on, would end up migrating to towns like this, Claremont, New Hampshire, named after Lord Claremont of England. So it's Claremont. This was a factory that burnt to the ground during World War II. This smokestack's the only thing that's left. And the wood from this footbridge is now gone completely. This used to be there's a dam here now, and it was a hydroelectric generator, and one of the guys who worked there, his name was Harry, he lived just across the street from me at Pleasant Valley Estates up there in Paddy Hollow, and I was there for, in this mobile home for about 8 years, good year and a half. After my mother died, we finally put the place up for sale and took off, got out of there. The ladies in the 1800s came down here, and they would work without breaks or anything under draconian situation, almost like slave labor. It was a sweatshop of its day. It's the 1600s. I get into it in the story here. The textile industry had become outsourced from England to the colonies in North America, namely the New England colonies. And so this outsourcing business is nothing new. It's endemic in human nature, I suppose. This particular painting, though, took me 7 months to do because of a lot of things. One of them was my dislocated painting shoulder. It was the Love Building. Okay, I forgot it's interactive here. The Love Building. The center factory in the painting is the Love Building. I understand it to be vacant now. It's for sale. I don't know if it's still for sale. Maybe some flowers grew in it, and it's forsythia. But it still has its own operable hydroelectric power supply coming from a dam which can't be seen here as it would be behind those huge rocks. My neighbor across the street from me worked there in the early half of the 20th century when it was a steel mill. Ah, thanks a million. If you're tired of that mill, you can yawn. This is taken in early spring. When the snow melt comes in early spring, the water gets high water. This was particularly high water year. This is kind of scary. And I was working at the neighboring Walmart, which was actually, they bought it from the sawmill out there near Washington Street. Washington Street had some beautiful antique buildings, and the city of Claremont, that's right, Claremont, you're on candid camera. The city government of Claremont and others tore down the houses in the name of progress and put up, you know, things like Burger King, McDonald's, and stuff like that. A fry alley over there. And Walmart was put there, and that used to be a sawmill. And when they were clearing some of the place, that they found stuff like cars in there with bodies in the trunks, you know, the skeletal remains of bodies in the trunks. I could go into details for you there, but. You know, I'll leave you to find that out for yourself sometime. And you know, when you start to find, nutcases following you around in cars with their cell phones linked, that's what happened to me. Anyway. Let's see. So we've got an interactive painting here. Let's click the smokestack. Sullivan Smokestack. So there, towering over nothing much. Sullivan Smokestack. That's about, sometimes, see, sorry, that's the best we can do. If you sneeze, say, achoo. No, that's not the best we can do. I guess we're going to have a problem here. Hate to do this while I'm in the middle of a real big shoe, yeah. I sneezed. All right, so there we go. I think we got something going on here. Sorry for the big pause. Okay, so that's Sullivan's smokestack. Okay, so second rock, blue sedimentary rock. Next to the reddish brown sedimentary rock is one that is distinctly blue in color. This is a magnificent and beautiful outcropping of stone, which I have climbed to the riverbed during the dry months out there on the riverbed. I just went during the dry months. There's hardly any water in there. And I went over and climbed in over there, and I climbed to the stone itself. It was something to clamber over that stone. The rock is almost a cupuric blue. I kept a small piece of it and have it with me somewhere in my room. Well, I don't have that room anymore. There must have been room at the top. Long since buried in my own little vortex of time under a couple of years of papers and catalogs. Let's see. Sullivan's Phantom Factory. As has become sadly usual with me, this is Sullivan's Phantom Factory. I find myself less and less able to remember details. This part of the scene is an area where a mishap occurred, the exact time of which I knew from a conversation with an observer, but since have forgotten exactly when the person said it had occurred. I actually talked to somebody on the scene. I should have had my little notepad with me. After all, I was trained to gather information in the Army, kind of like a journalist, you know, so. My first training came when I took the train from New York City all the way down to Georgia. One of the cars burned up on the way. I think they forgot to lube the wheels or something. But anyway, talk about training, huh? Literal training. Okay, I think I was 19, it was in the 1940s or so when this thing burnt to the ground. This was once the location of a factory called, I think, Sullivan's Factory. Anyway, just before that fateful day, the factory had become a depot and storage facility for some pretty potent stuff, whatever it was. The day it caught fire, it burned so hot they couldn't put it out. So they let it go, and it burned day and night, and even longer, I think. The end result is what you see in the mid-ground between the rocks and the hills on the other side. Nothing but some bits of framework and the smokestack remain. So let's see what we got here. We went over this, the love. Let's go over this. Let's see, let's click. Must be this, maybe the bridge has something. Okay, the footbridge. Barely visible in this painting, you can see the delicate lattice of all that remains of the well-traveled footbridge which the factory workers used to get across the river to work from the Washington Street side of Claremont to the in the 1800s. So they came from the Washington Street side, crossed the bridge to the factory, which is over here on the Water Street side. Okay, now all that's left is a slender rusted framework. Slender rusted framework. It's something when you get to this rock right next to this tree. This tree's probably pretty big now, or maybe it has fallen over. These trees only live for a little while, and then they just fall over, like you see this one has already done. These being the birch trees. Okay, white birch. Okay, softwood tree. Okay, so now all that's left is a slender rusted framework. It has a future, though. You know, by the time you get there this time, you may actually see it. It has a future, an avenir. As eventually there are plans to rebuild it, and to rebuild, and tourists from the center on the other side of the river, which is already mostly built circa 2001, will be able to walk across and visit the mill. Let's take a short break here. I'll press the okay. Let's head back to our situation room. Okay, now we're going to click the building. A Water Street mill still standing. One of the mills still left standing along the rapids area of the Sugar River between the two dams. Between two dams, actually. So this is a town that really does give a damn. So let's see what we do. Okay. Back in 1997, I talked with the Claremont mayor who saved it. A lot of money had been spent stabilizing this and other mill buildings along Water Street. Many other mills were lost because it was just too costly for the city of just over $13,000 to save them all. And they would have simply become too dangerous. Eventually, this mill will perhaps be restored and apparently be used by a business. So I got this painting done back in its sort of interim stage there, when it had become stabilized at some expense to the town, and later on it would be taken over as a business, so it would be a business area down there. That's a good idea. They did the same thing in the town of Lebanon, further up the Connecticut River, which it runs at the base of Mount Escutney. This is a part of Mount Escutney up here. Shining through the mist. It's mysterious. Anyway, so, okay. As soon as I find out more, I'll include the updates in this and other pages. Ha ha, when they stopped making front page, I don't know, maybe Microsoft makes an update to front page, but it would have another name, and it just went over my head, and I've been too busy anyway doing these YouTube things, so I haven't written to my website since 2005, I think. Well, a couple of times in maybe 2000 later on, I don't know. Excuse me. So eventually, so the roof actually is slightly slanted. I didn't make a mistake here. The roof actually is slightly slanted as it appears in that painting, perhaps in order to allow the inordinately copious winter snow accumulations in this part of New England to travel off the edge, and the snowpack tends to glaciate and move around the month of March. I think I wrote an incoherent sentence there. Basically, you know what I'm trying to say. Yeah, as I say, two say are better than one, huh? Touche is better than a touche because it's che, the say. Anyway, it's really the snow melt that is causing the river to be so active in this painting. I think it was active in the painting, but in reality, actually, these waves actually start to do this. This funny wave-like motion in the river making these patterns. Let's see what the river says. The Sugar River. Oh, I can do it this way. Okay, this is the Sugar River. If the Sugar River is seen in the painting, as a darker blue green than it actually appeared in the real scene, were always this high and active, it would be formidable indeed, but rather especially during the drier summer months, while the whole American East Coast bakes under the frequent Bermuda high pressure cells that hover over the section of the continent for weeks at a time, sometimes a couple of months maybe, the river is reduced to a trickle at its bottom. It got its name from the prevalence of sugar maple, which in colonial times was in demand as a resource for maple sugar. In reality, the river at one time ran red from all the dye dumped in by wool mills upstream. Of course, this is also because of its many dams along its course, which also helps form a large lake at its source, Lake Sunapee. Still in all, high or low, the flow of water over this section for rapids, which at any time make an awesome sight. I left out the M, its form. The flow of water over this section forms rapids, and it's an awesome sight. Right next door here, over there, this way, is the motor vehicles department. And on the stairwell, there's this window, and you can look out right on these rapids, and it is, as they say now, totally awesome. And on that note, we can float a boat. Let's see if we got the trees up here. Trees and vegetation on top of the rocks. The rock outcropping is so massive that it has soil on top and sports a growth of vegetation and trees. The trees almost look out of place, but are holding their own and doing pretty well, as if to serve as a woody coiffure for the blue and brown boulders. That makes them bolder than ever, doesn't it? They go to a bowling alley. Made of steel, that would be bowling alloy. Yep, we got something here. Steam clouds. The city of Claremont still gets electricity from the river, although the cost of electricity here is the greatest in the nation. Well, at least before the California crisis. I'll have to re-authenticate that. The Sugar River, to a small degree, contributes to the electric current. Over the roof of the Love Building, you can see steam from the waters from another dam obscured by the edifice. This happens in cold weather and even can occur around the time of the thaws, which also are the time of the maple sugar harvest throughout New England, incidentally. Maple sugar and honey were some of the sweeteners used in the colonial days before they were replaced by sugar, and man, did sugar come in with a vengeance out there in the islands of the Smile Lands over there in the other place. And I'll think of that someday. Let's see, we're going on up here, and we have this. Mount Ascutney in the distance, emerging from the mist and fog of this cloudy, foggy day. And one guy went for a walk out here and ended up with a fog in his throat. But anyway, emerging from the mist of this and fog of this cloudy, foggy day, just after a rainstorm, is one of the small but majestic mountains of Vermont. Vermont has large mountains, but this is one of its smaller ones, Mount Ascutney. On the slope, opposite this view, there actually is a very nice ski resort and groomed slopes, a part of Vermont and New Hampshire's winter sports industry. And I might also add that Mount Ascutney is an extinct volcano, and there's gold up there. One of the mechanics over at the Subaru place, his wife used to go up to a stream up there and gather up a pail of sediment, take it home to her kitchen in the wintertime and pan the sediment for gold dust. You got the dust. So, talk about a dust bowl, huh? Okay. So, we have to do some Okay. A lot of work went into this one, 7 months worth, though I have often worked in plein air in the past, and perhaps will again. This one was done from a photograph which I shot of the river running through the city of Claremont, New Hampshire, called the Sugar River, which runs from Lake Sunapee to the Connecticut River. This river is normally hardly a trickle on a midsummer's day, but it can be quite something in early spring after the snow accumulation begins to thaw. Claremont is one of the older American cities built originally around this locale that you see in the painting, as many New England towns of the 17th and 18th century were, around the power of a stream or river. In this case, it all started with the construction of a grist mill, over which, upon its completion, the inhabitants got together and had a celebration. Finally, the last mills on the Claremont section of the Sugar River took to the very thing that would start them away from their centuries-long tenure there by the river. By the river and the street on the other side of the large building on the left. On the other side of the dilapidated footbridge, aptly called Water Street. Electric power. Now, as we all know, there is only one basic thing that ever made the 20th century anything more special than the others before it, and that was cheap power. The cheap power of petroleum. It also replaced slavery as the means to empire. Well, it seems that we are running out of the stuff. And we may have to go back to water power again. It's, as my old pun says, what are you talking about? All that petroleum didn't go away. The wisest thing mankind could do was use it up. All that carbon is still there. But now instead of hydrocarbon, it's oxycarbon. I digress to cover this briefly. Oxycarbon is the renewable side of petroleum. Here the fuel comes from the fractional distillation of the oil pressed from seeds of plants that extract the oxycarbons from the troposphere. So, how are you going to do that, Bunky? Well, looks like you're going to have to let that workforce get back to the farm. You think I mean the 16% of the world that is global farmland still existing? No. Man is by nature a digger. I'm talking about the 45% of arable land emerging from the terracing of the mountains above the timber lines and the production of topsoil using the same types of mountain eaters now used for making the dust mixed with tar in road production. You complain that it would take armies to do that. That's one thing that nations have enough of. I might add that you don't expect to see the initiative in mankind to do it. That's the problem with psycho-economics, the so-called merchants of cool. It's like poison gas in World War I, in that it eventually floats back to your side too. The renewable resource in a country's intellectual base, which, since it cannot be predicted where it will come from, usually is inscripted to become the teenage cannon fodder for the military-industrial complex's next generation of weaponry. So, the other scenario is that man may have to revert to the Iron Age family forges powered by water. You can see the remains of one such unit in my drawing, The Blacksmith Covered Bridge. Click to go there. Blacksmith Covered Bridge. Yes, there it is. I found an old wheel over on the other side one time. It was really cool. And man may have to revert to the mills concept of the 17th and 18th century. But these days you're going to have a much better benefits package than you did then. So you increase the benefits package of your indigenous workers, and you can take a minimum wage. You know, if they're paid a minimum wage, and you can extend their buying power with engineered benefits so that you change, say, a $10 an hour wage into the equivalent of $25 an hour. Now you're talking. People can earn a living wage that way. Okay. I had the fortune of talking to some of the ladies who once worked to one of the ladies who once worked in the mills, such as the mill relics you see in this painting. And my neighbor across the street once worked in the Love Building, seen here in the center of the painting, which, though now abandoned, still has a workable hydroelectric generator system at the base of a large dam, just out of sight of this view behind those rocks in the right foreground. The lady's name, who I don't recall, was at Dartmouth Hitchcock Hospital waiting for a CAT scan, as was my elderly mother, which was why I was there on that day. I remember competing with the television quiz show noising in the background to be able to hear her as she talked of life in the mills long ago. Most of the women came from farms in the region and worked all day long for low wages, and they apparently, from what I could glean from our conversation, had no breaks and no time off for lunch. It was an extremely difficult life. it was definitely extremely difficult, apparently. Actually, not definitely, but apparently. Fraught with hazard and long hours of toil. Of course, I haven't been privy to any further information as to how the working conditions might have improved after a while. But the mills met their demise, first of all, because labor became cheaper elsewhere, and secondly, because electric power enabled industry to move away from the waterside, going farther and farther afield in search of the cheaper and cheaper labor force, until finally the production facilities are now mostly found in the so-called, quote, third world, unquote, on the farthest extreme of the world. I paid visits to many areas of the third world or developing nations which had the cheap labor used to make many of the products we use today. I spent about 7 months in Indonesia, where I supported myself teaching English and French, and was able to complete the first draft of my own English textbook, and also complete my first preliminary experiments to prove my endocrine theory of learning, which would theoretically enable most human beings, and maybe even some of the other forms of intelligence, such as some species of primates, which can use sign language, to be fluent in some rudimentary form of English in the time span of 1/2 of 1 year to 2 years, without having to learn grammar. It was my first, and so far only, attempt to get the classroom out of the Stone Age. It's the classroom environment. Apparently, the student needs a lot more stimulus for the brain to begin to form the nerve tissue necessary for a memory that constitutes something learned. But to report my findings on the labor situation from one investigation I was able to perform, since most of my time had to be taken up with my teaching, I found that the population emerged over the centuries from an agrarian background to find themselves in the late 20th century thrust into a post-colonialist combination of plantation systems and latently more and more industry. The illusion that Java Island, one of the most densely populated areas of the world, is crammed from shore to shore by struggling masses of overpopulation is served by the fact that most of the visitors to that island usually, rarely, venture out of urban areas such as Jakarta, where a walk down the wide city streets at midnight reveals large families sleeping in clusters on the sidewalk. What was not apparent is the vast amount of empty terrain devoted to cash crops. In fact, just in my neighborhood in Jakarta, which my associate nicknamed Coconut Alley, the streets nearby were lined with mobile booths lit by kerosene mantle lanterns, where retail items were sold by, once again, whole families, parents and several children usually, who upon closing slept inside these places in the small aisle not wider than a couple of feet. I find that these people could have continued in their agrarian life, but it appears that they have been pushed out by the plantations. I saw the same with the rubber plantations in Malaysia and the sugar plantations in Fiji. This is not really helpful to their economy. The difference between an economy with a backbone and one that's not more than a spineless amoeba is simply this: the independence of the individual family farm. It seems that even though the financial success of a 50% plus agrarian nation causes a vast increase in wealth, it does pose a problem for industry, and that is where to find the labor. It reminds me of the song by Woody Guthrie about the farmer's neighbors in Oklahoma in the 30s that got tractored out by the cats. That, in tandem with the misconception of monoculture, such as was observed in the rubber plantations in Malaysia. In fact, concentrating one species in such large areas causes the organisms to be susceptible to such things as disease, which I understand is happening in the two rubber plantations, in monocultural plantations throughout the world. I would argue that a 5% or less of a nation's population in agriculture is counterproductive and perhaps extremely so. I noticed that only in the United States, but also in France and Spain, and would have had, true confessions, dyslexia strikes again, give it a raise, and, come through the arbitration. Let's see, I noticed that, not only in the United States, but also in France and Spain, and would have had more input on other nations if I had the time. Fiji threw me out with only 12 hours to leave the country. That, coupled with an extreme and ever-growing dependence on military-industrial complexes, such as the one I observed in Bandung, Indonesia, where the Indonesian armed forces work closely with the United States to train with an ever-growing stockpile of American armament and aircraft, leads to an increasing demand for laborers in an industrial and less agrarian-based economic environment. Now, of course, in all fairness, this was back in the 80s, early 80s, when I was over there in Indonesia, which I nicknamed Indolent Amnesia. Anyway, you can go. This goes with the contemporary idea that a workforce that is too costly to employ in a developed nation must buy its sneakers or shoes from a developing nation, countries like Indonesia, now China, and now Vietnam. Items routine for everyday life in a largely wealthy nation, which once were made at home in that nation, but now come from a poor country where a successful family pools their meager income to pay their $30 a month rent for that corrugated metal home in a village on the outskirts of some urban area or industrial site. Meanwhile, the poor family in the wealthy nation pools their income to afford their $500 a month apartment. Good luck on that. Now it's reduced to $700 a month, 30-year-old motel room, equipped with a small fridge and microwave. Okay, and in Southern California, it can become $1,000 a month. The price has gone up, hasn't it? And now you can only rent if you have an acceptable credit rating. Often, it's more affordable to live in a motel than an apartment. Or if the apartment is too elaborate for those treated by the wealthy as peons, peasants. There are nations as developed as the United States where I understand half the population now lives in mobile homes. They are only mobile for limited distances because of the expense of highway charges for large loads. I can't say that for new billeting relocation of whole populations. I can't say that the new billeting relocation of whole populations is engineered. I cannot say that at this point. But otherwise, it is indeed fortuitous concerning the global scale at which it's happening. Of course, while abroad, I had little opportunity to inspect the industrial sites, but I had a chance to look around a little bit. The trips I was able to make through the Indonesian tea plantations, or the sugar plantations in Viti Levu, or the tuning packing plant in Tutuila Island in eastern Samoa, where I did some 30 or so drawings that are now lost somewhere, helped me to get a perspective on the workforce that fuels the production of Western goods. Bear in mind that the Samoans have some resource in the beautiful coral reef that still exists, where in Tutuila Island alone, they can go out themselves and collect seafood. In 1988, when I was there, they gathered an average of 40 tons per year. So that takes us back to colonial America, the third world of its day. Except that during those times, a lot more people knew how to make things from scratch. And that takes us specifically to the area of the Sugar River with its auspicious sets of rapids in various areas along the stream running from Sunapee to the Connecticut Valley, where the Connecticut River divides New Hampshire from Vermont. It's over here. Here in the Claremont area, from the time that first grist mill was, perhaps painstakingly and perhaps perilously finally assembled, until 1936, when you see this scene. That's not 1936. My dyslexia strikes. You see, it's 96 here, and it looked to me to be 30, but it was 90, okay? Finally assembled, until 1996. When you see this scene, the New Hampshire area and all of New England figured in heavily to the industry of the 18th century. When the timber from the excellent sylvan, deciduous, and pine forests provided the material for the masts, and the timbers of the wind-powered shipping of the day, the wet climate and the semi-mountainous terrain lent itself to the water-powered industry of that time as well. As the industry grew around the umber brick of Water Street and others like it throughout New England, so did the labor force that worked for those industries. The factories grew and grew until Claremont became quite prosperous. One of the famous manufacturers there was Mr. Moody, who made shoes in the late 1800s. He also did a lot for Claremont, including constructing an elegant hotel, the Moody Building, which today is an office block. Let's have a look. Yes, Hush, a look at the Moody Building, will you? There it is, drawing I did from a photograph there of the Moody Building. It's still, I think, I don't know if it's still a hotel. It's office buildings now, I think. We'll have to get into that a little later. But anyway, the Moody Building. That's quite something. Yes, I forgot where I was, my place. I used to be terrible at this. When I was reading Dick and Jane in the first grade, I always kept losing my place. They gave us these paper markers, but somehow every time with my dyslexia I looked out the window, my marker would move. So I didn't know whether I was supposed to be with Spot or Puff or whoever it was at the time. Anyway, yes, the Moody Building, today an office block. Mr. Moody was also an inventor, and relics of some of his inventions, his ingenious devices, are still in evidence at his former mansion on Arch Road in the southern section of Claremont. Eventually, the shoe works moved south up the Mason-Dixon line for the cheaper labor there. And of course, the rest is, as it were, history. In fact, I think the painting is most about the one thing that I find extremely fascinating, and that is time itself. Yes, time itself. There in the work, between the rocks in the foreground and Mount Ascutney fading in the distant mist, one can almost visualize the dimension of time. This is like maybe the holy grail of fine art, is to depict time itself, an invisible element all too prevalent in our existence. Okay. I wrote a song in Paris in 1980 called Torrential Time, one of the many I have penned examining the temporal subject. And if your computer has the ability to play the background music, which apparently computers can't do anymore, you might have just heard it. The use of this kind of representationalism that you see in this painting affords me the chance to take a deep look into the object frozen in a moment of time by the camera and then symbolized by the mind. What took so long was the fact that each square inch of the work became a painting in itself. The only thing I did quickly was the sky and Mount Ascutney. That part was done in one day. The rest took 7 months. And I'll go over the poetry of the song Torrential Time. The cold rain fell in torrential time and washed the mountains' hills. And in the valleys far below, the the dust was formed in rills. Well, it came to be in the heat of day, men working in their sweaty way, to bake the bricks for the buildings tall, without delay dug up the clay. The cities grew with brick on brick in umber streets, and all too quick to house the farmers whose lands were robbed, forcing his labor in a landlord's grip, where learning becomes the tool of greed, and the murderous war, how the students succeed to rob the land of simple lives, the farmer, his children, his hopes, his wives. Just cram them into cities baked of miry clay, where war and oppression have full sway, where the highland dust beyond the years, once washed by rain, is rinsed by tears.